Hello guys, my name is Adrian and welcome to my Metal Gear Solid 5 review. So this is a pretty special video for me because I don't know if you guys have seen the other content on my channel, but I'm a huge Metal Gear Solid fan and I've actually talked about all these other Metal Gear games in this series that I created called Metal Gear Solid, My Thoughts, and Metal Gear Solid 5, it was, you know, it's the last Metal Gear Solid game made by Hideo Kojima. I was lucky enough to meet him. So I was extremely excited to get to this. And the reason why I waited a while before I did Metal Gear Solid 5 is that I just really wanted to play it the most amount of time possible. And I wanted like the hype to go by, and I didn't want to be influenced by what I read or by what other people said. I just wanted to give my 100% honest review of this game as a huge Metal Gear Solid fan and as a huge fan of video games in general. So that's why I waited some time. And yeah, let's get right to it. In anticipation of Metal Gear Solid 5, I actually replayed the Metal Gear Solid saga again. So the way I did it is I did Solid Snake's story followed by Big Boss's story. So the order that I played them was Metal Gear Solid, Metal Gear Solid 2, Metal Gear Solid 4, and then I played Metal Gear Solid 3, Metal Gear Solid Peace Walker, and Metal Gear Solid 5 Ground Zeroes. So yes, I know I did not play Metal Gear 1 and 2. I have played them before, but I decided not to replay them because I just didn't have enough time leading up to it. I knew that those take some time too. Metal Gear Solid 5 Ground Zeroes, I actually had a chance to play it 100%. So that was pretty exciting for me because I really got to know the game very well, and I got to know the mechanics very well, and I became very familiar with playing that sort of Metal Gear. These are my notes, actually. So I'm gonna be looking at this paper periodically just so I remember what I wanna talk about and stuff like that. So here we go. This is actually the last one in my series of My Thoughts because I don't think I'm gonna be doing another one because I pretty much covered every single Metal Gear game in existence. I never released the Metal Gear Solid 4 one in English, so if you would like to see that one, please let me know in the comments. So, all right, I know I've said like, we're gonna start, but now we're really gonna start. The first thing I wanted to talk about Metal Gear Solid 5, since it's such a huge focus of the game, is the gameplay, just the raw sneaking and taking guards out and all that stuff. It really is the best the series has ever had. It's really just, Hideo Kojima has just refined absolutely everything he's been building on since 1987, since the very first Metal Gear. And this, I feel, is his true realization of what it would feel like to infiltrate a compound, what he's been trying to make since that very first Metal Gear game he made so many years ago. And I think that there's so many incredible refinements, and yes, there are a couple things that just did not work that well. I'm gonna get into that later, but I wanna get into the stuff that I just think is so amazing and awesome about the game. So, sprinting, I feel like a lot of people, myself included, might have felt like, oh my god, this is becoming too much like Splinter Cell because then Fisher can run and now Snake can run too fast and it's gonna be so easy to avoid guards and stuff like that. I feel that, yes, in Ground Zeroes, it was really easy to take advantage of the sprinting and the checkpoint mechanic because you could like sprint to one end of the map, get caught, checkpoint, and then all the guards, they don't know where you are, right? And in here, I feel like since the map is so large, and then sometimes you get into a situation and you want to get out of the situation quickly, so you got to sprint away, or sometimes you're sprinting to get to the chopper. Get to the chopper, like Arnold Schwarzenegger. So I feel it adds a lot to the game. It doesn't take away of the game. The auto cover, I know as well, like a lot of people are kind of like, oh, I really like pressing a button to make sure that I'm up against the wall. And I feel like the auto cover, for the most time, it works really well. It does get a little tricky when you want to like detach and go into another wall, because then you like sometimes pops out all the way and then the guards see you. But for the most part, I was not really frustrated by the auto cover. That was fine. And there was also a lot of criticism too of the ability to be able to go and I forgot what it's called, but to go into like the slow motion mode where someone spots you and then you're like, whoa, and then you got a time to take a pot shot at them. And I think that, yeah, that kind of makes the game a little easy, but you can play with it turned off, which is exactly what I did. So I turned that off, and you can also play with the chicken hat, and I obviously turned off the chicken hat. That's the ability that they give you, and then it's very difficult for the guards to spot you. I think you can't be spotted three times or something like that when you were supposed to be spotted. I don't know, I never used it, but it's there for the people that really need a lot of help. But for those of us that don't need all that help, you can just turn all that off, so it's fine. And crouch walking looks amazing. I mean, I know I touched on this too on my Ground Zeroes, My Thoughts, But it's just the animation of it finally looks incredibly natural, and it's very useful to crouch walk, and it doesn't look as awkward as it did in Metal Gear Solid 4, because I was really excited that I could finally crouch walk in Metal Gear Solid 4, but it just looked so awkward because he was like he was just walking hunched over. It didn't really seem like a stealthy maneuver. It just seemed like his back hurt. And moving around in general, it's awesome. And all the controls feel incredibly responsive, very intuitive, and you can just do so many things without pressing so many buttons as you used to have to in the classic Metal Gears. The buddy system. So the buddy system, I feel like, work really well. The buddies that I used the most, I used Quiet a lot initially once I finally developed her tranquilizer rifle, because if you've seen my other Metal Gear reviews, like, I don't like killing in Metal Gear games if given the option. So I couldn't use her to take guards out when she had the lethal sniper rifle. Sometimes she took guys out accidentally to restart the mission. But once she got the tranquilizer rifle, I feel she's very useful in spotting the guys and then taking them out. When they happen to spot you, she'll take them out before they call an alert or anything, unless they have a helmet, then she takes two shots, and then by that time more people come to you. But she was very useful. And I touched on this a little bit on this other video that I did about Metal Gear Solid 5. I've made it this far without saying any spoilers, but there are spoilers in this video. So if you have not played the game, please don't watch the rest of this video, I would say, because I am going to touch on spoiler material once every so often. In the end, I'm going to be discussing like heavy spoilers. So if you don't want any spoilers, just don't see this video. Play the game. Come back once you've finished it. Okay. Back on. Okay, good. All right, so now let's go into a little bit of Unquiet. So I was extremely disappointed and frustrated and sad and mad when she just left the team, and she really did leave your team. Like, you could no longer play with her. Like, I was so frustrated that actually I told my brother about this, because I didn't just ruin it for him, but I did tell him what was coming, kind of. And I said, like, if you don't do this, you might lose someone. And he was like, oh, what is it? And so then he said it was okay that I tell him. So I told him, and then he just did not pass that part. So Quiet stayed on his team anyway, and he put the butterfly tattoo. So then, I mean, the butterfly emblem. So then you can keep her with that too. So that's why that was our solution to the game, because he was also playing it too. And since there was no way to go back, and there was no way that I was going to replay all the hours that I spent playing that game, so that was our temporary solution. So I was extremely happy once they released that patch, that if you pass the mission, I think 7 times, you're able to get her again. So I was extremely excited about that. I felt that that was a very smart decision. And yes, it was good in the sense that you did feel the pain of her leaving, like if she had really did leave you and your whole team for real. But I feel, in terms of a gameplay perspective, it's just, I think, a little bit unfair to the gamer in that you didn't know that the rug was going to be pulled out of you like that in such a major way. So that was Quiet. And then the other buddy that I use a lot is D-Dog, and I think he's incredibly useful. I would even say he might be the best buddy in the game, just because that you can use him in doing that two-person takedown. Because there are many situations in the game where their guards are patrolling 2x2, right? So it's very difficult to sneak up on one without the other guy noticing. So what you end up doing is you send the dog, and then the dog, well, or wolf, if you want to call it, you send D-Dog after him. And I don't like to kill people. So he stuns him, and then right as he's stunning one, the other guy turns around, and by the time he turns around, bam, you slam him to the ground, and then you do the two-person takedown. And he howls, and it's really cool. And also the really cool thing about D-Dog is that he will spot every single bad guy in the immediate vicinity. And that is so, so useful, because it really prevents those moments where you're walking around and just around the corner, there's some guy that spots you out of nowhere. And you're like, oh man. So it prevents that situation really well. And again, like, if you feel like the buddies make the game too easy, you can always take the buddies off. So I really enjoy that they gave you that option. And if you want to go like full infiltration mode, like if you want this to be the closest approximation to real life, I would definitely, you take off the ability to mark people, and you take off any and all buddies, and you really go in with as limited amount of equipment as possible. And it's so intense. It can get frustrating, but it is extremely intense to infiltrate, even if it's a side mission, or even if you just make up a mission by like taking guards out. It really does simulate what what would feel like infiltrating. I mean, I've never done that in real life, but I feel like that's, it's the closest approximation that we can get to that in a video game at the moment. So yeah, that brings me to how there's so many different ways to infiltrate bases now. I feel like that is one of the best parts of this game, is that it really is open world stealth, in that you're given an objective, but as to how you complete that objective, it's entirely up to you. There's so many toys at your disposal. Or if you don't want to use any toys, you can just go in a day, go in at night, go lethal, go non-lethal. The way you distract guards, or how you get them to come to you, either by knocking or using the little inflatable guy, or by using your buddies. There's so many different ways to accomplish your objective, that it really gives the game so much variety. A big thing that I talk about a lot in my other reviews of Metal Gears is what my brother and I call sections. So sections in Metal Gear are those sections where you go into a base, or you go into a section, and there are a lot of guards, and then you have to evade detection by the guards. So in other words, any section, any part of the game, any part of a Metal Gear game that's not an obligatory action scene or a boss fight. So all the parts where you're just infiltrating. And this game has so many sections in it. And yes, you do go back to them several times, because there's only two giant maps. But since you're always infiltrating with different circumstances and with different enemy patrols, it's not just a matter of memorizing where the guards are and then you can just go at it. And then every time you go back to it, it's like, oh, remember that guy pops over here so I can take a shot over there and stuff like that. So it's always evolving. It's always very dynamic. I really enjoy too how there's just so many missions. Like, besides the main missions, there's all these side missions. And the one that I enjoyed the most actually was the one where you had to eliminate the heavily armed guard. Those were my favorite, because my favorite thing to do in this kind of game is to just remain completely undetected, just be a ghost, and then take down every soldier without the soldiers being alerted. And that's exactly what that mission was about. You're going to a section, and then you have to take out all the soldiers without them seeing you. And the best part, and what I most enjoyed about it, is that it doesn't let you do pot shots. You know, just take out your sniper rifle or take out your gun and boom, 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 and then that's it. Because they all have super heavily armored equipment, and so then by the time you start shooting, everybody gets alerted. So it basically forces you to go up to the guy and CQC him in any way you want, and that's my favorite part of playing these kinds of games, just sneaking up to the enemy without him knowing, and boom, taking him down. That's awesome. That's my biggest thrill in playing stealth games. And yes, there's also what I wrote here, the endless cycle of replayability, like Peace Walker. It's the shirt, Peace Walker. Peace Walker is actually one of my favorite Metal Gear games too. So that replayability, I just love how the gameplay feeds into the mother base system so well. So when after you do your mission, you recruit your soldiers, you go back to mother base, and then you play around with them. You know, you manage your soldiers, you see what you're gonna spend your GMP on, you see how things are going at the base, you send them off into different missions, and then you wanna develop this certain equipment that you want, but you need this, and so then you go back and then you play more missions. So it just keeps you going and going and going and going. And the fact that you can replay any mission that you want at any given point without having to replay it linearly like in all the other Metal Gear games, that I think is a great benefit to the game as well. You can just always go back to replay that section that you really loved instead of having to go through the entire game again. And yeah, it was so responsive, intuitive, fun, dynamic. I just wrote all these great things about it. And I wrote here too, why is infiltrating so fun? So I feel like infiltration in this game is so incredibly fun because you just never know what you're gonna get. And you're always improvising and you're always kind of adapting to what is being thrown at you. Like, maybe you were supposed to take this guard out, so now you have to adapt your strategy because he's bringing in his buddies. So now you have to take out four guards instead of one guard, but then there's another guy up there and then he's looking at you. Like, there's always all these different things that add to it. And then the coolest thing too is that for a while, you know, if you want to make up your very own mission, you can. And I did that several times, of being like, I'm just gonna go and I'm gonna go and try to take every single resource available in this base and take out every single guard as well. So I can bring, so not only will I get the resources, but I'll also get the guards too. And that's incredibly fun too. You don't even have to play the designated side missions or the designated main missions to have fun with the game. It's just your sandbox. Oh, and this is pretty funny. So as you all know, in this iteration of Metal Gear Solid 5 Phantom Pain, oh, I haven't even shown the games here. So here's Metal Gear Solid 5 The Phantom Pain, and here's the Steelbook edition that comes with it. If you get the, what was it called? Like the super special edition of the game, the one that comes with the bionic arm. I actually did an unboxing of that if you want to see it as well. So, as you all know, in this one, I'll go into this later a little bit, you're playing as Venom Snake, which is actually another snake, it's not Big Boss. So in order to differentiate that, Kojima did give him a new look. So in other words, gone is a bandana, and I know that was since the end of Peace Walkers when he took off the bandana. Now he has no bandana in Ground Zeroes. And just, you know, this side of the box, that's Phantom Pain. So he took off the bandana and he actually has his horn over here, and he also has a ponytail instead of his traditional mullet. Now, as I was playing through the game, I've never been a huge fan of that look. I don't really like the horn protruding through there, and I don't like the ponytail. I much prefer the mullet. So it was really exciting for me to find out in one of the early gameplay videos that they were using teasing the game that it is possible to get the bandana in this game and to equip the bandana. So it was pretty intense for me to find out how to get the bandana, because I wanted to get it as quick as possible but without spoiling the game for myself. So I had to be really careful with the forums and stuff that tell you how to get it. But luckily the Metal Gear community, we're all a bunch of nice dudes. So we always make special care that we're not gonna be spoiling the game for other people. So when I saw in the forums, people were like, oh, please, no spoilers. And they were like, no, just get to this particular mission and then you'll obtain the thing necessary to be able to develop it. Like, they didn't say any plot details or exactly what mission that was, just a mission number. So I played it all through to get to that mission. What was it? I think it was like 30 something, 39 maybe. I don't remember which one it was in particular. It was one of the maybe side missions. I don't remember, it was a while ago. But I finally got to that mission and then I got the bandana, but then it was like, oh, now you need to develop this guy. Now you need to get a certain amount of resources. Now you get a certain amount of level in this level and what was the two levels? I think it was your R&D and your medical. I think the R&D and the medical branch, if I'm not mistaken, had to be the ones that you had to level up to a certain extent to be able to begin development on the bandana. So remember, I played like 6 or 7 hours of my gameplay time of this game, which, by the way, I don't think I even covered this, but yeah, I played the game for about 160 hours. So I have invested a considerable chunk of my time playing this game. So I would say like 6 or 7 hours, not exaggerating, was what I took to get this bandana, because I really wanted it as quickly as possible. And you're not supposed to get it until really late in the game, but I got it as soon as I got that item. I wanted to play all the other rest of the game with the bandana. So I shuffled around my guys. I like lowered the level in all the other departments just so I could get my R&D up. And then I waited for a while. This is actually when I found out that the game has a sort of pseudo real-time component to it. Like, if you're wondering why a couple of your guards just forever stay in the prison, you're like, oh my God, one is you should always be getting rid of the people that are just like taking up space that don't go into a certain category, because if those people stay in like the standby, none of your guards in the prison are gonna go into standby. So always be deleting people in standby to make sure all the guards from the prison go into being able to assign them to places. Once I figured out that was real time, I would just leave the PlayStation 4 running and just let it there for like an hour or two, so then all the guys could come out and then I could assign them to level the bandana up. And then finally, we'll get to the place where I could get the bandana. And then finally I got it and I was so excited to play with that bandana, and I actually played with the Ground Zeroes. I think you can see it there with the Ground Zeroes outfit too. So the Ground Zeroes outfit with the bandana, it was awesome. It was like playing Peace Walker. I really enjoyed that. And once they offered the DLC of getting the Tiger Stripe camo, oh man, that's like you're playing Metal Gear Solid 3 again. It was so cool. It is so cool to go into that, to play the game with the classic Tiger Stripe camouflage with the bandana. It's like, yes. I feel like the guards are the smartest they've ever been in the entire series, but I do feel that sometimes the guards are a little too smart in that they kind of hurt the experience a little bit instead of helping the experience. And what do I mean by this? By being so smart, there are a lot of things that you can't do anymore, even though the game is kind of trying to get you to do it. For example, let's say you want to use your sniper rifle, right? You finally got the silenced tranquilizer shot. Right, you got the little silencer, you got the tranquilizer gun, so you're really excited to use the tranquilizer rifle. So you take a guy out, and then the thing is, even if the other guards don't see him go down, they'll suddenly turn around and be like, oh, wait a minute, where's the guy that's supposed to be up there? And then they're gonna get really cautious, and then they're going to go into a little like mini alert. It's not really an alert, but they go into like caution mode where they start patrolling with their guns, And then you're immediately, they don't get out of caution mode until a lot of time passes. I mean, you can, if you want, go out of the section, go smoke the cigar, make time pass, tap pass, 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 and then finally they'll get back to normal mode. But I feel like it's sometimes, they sometimes get into that caution mode really quickly with you not really doing anything. Sometimes if you smack on the wall more than once, they'll go right back into caution mode. Or sometimes when you throw, the throwing the magazine of the gun actually still kind of works. Most of the time, usually they don't call for backup. But sometimes, for example, you throw the little balloon inflatable guy. And then, oh my God, I saw something. I'm gonna call for backup. And then the guy is like, oh, I'm gonna check something out. Oh, make sure to take someone with you. And so then two guys go and you're like, well, no, I can't do anything about that. Like, so it kind of doesn't really encourage you to experiment with a lot of the toys that they give you because you know that you're actually exposing yourself way more. And so the camo index, I feel that I understand why they took off the actual number, right? To get, so you can be more immersed into it and so you can kind of think about more of like, oh, is this camo more effective because it's in this sort of terrain and stuff like that. But the fact remains that they're not as blind as they used to be. And I know that that's more real, that they can see farther, but it's just, it's a little lame in that, like I said before, I love to crouch walk, right? And you can't really crouch walk that often now because you gotta crawl everywhere. Like if you, what I found, if you move crouch walking past 40 meters, so if you're like 38 meters away from him or 36 meters away from him, moving, crouching, you can be like slowly crouch walking, like barely even moving, he will see you. Not see you alert mode, but he will be like, oh, what's that? And then he'll go to investigate. And before, like, the guards were a lot more nearsighted, so you could crouch walk a little closer to them before they start getting all worried, right? Like, I'm not saying crouch walk right in front of them while they're, like, seeing you, then that'd be break the game, right? But, I mean, 40 meters away is a considerable distance, so then what you end up doing a lot of the time is that you end up crawling a lot. And, I mean, crawling looks cool, and there are upgrades that you can get with your bionic arm that somehow influences how fast you can crawl, so you can crawl, I think, twice as fast as you start out. But still, like, I don't want to spend the whole game just crawling all over the place because that's the safest way. Like, I would like to crouch walk too. That's kind of part of the stealth fantasy, and that if you're low to the ground, people won't see you, that if you're standing up. So I felt like by making them so smart and by taking away your camo index, you're kind of left in a place where you want to be really safe, right? And rather be safe than sorry. And to be safe, the safest way to play is to just crawl all over the place. And for me, that's not incredibly exciting because it's very slow and you really can't do anything while you're on the ground except take pot shots. So that's why I felt like the guards sometimes were a little bit too intelligent. And I feel like something that should have definitely returned was the fact that they used to call for backup, like in Metal Gear Solid 2. Like if a guard would see you, he would be alerted, right? And you get the alert, but then you wouldn't get a bunch of soldiers swarming in on your location unless he called for backup on the walkie-talkie. And not only did he have to bring the walkie-talkie to his head, he had to start speaking and he had to say there was something wrong. So in Metal Gear Solid 5, they took that out. And what happens is that when you're spotted and you don't take the guard out, he will immediately sound the alert automatically. And guards will start swarming to your location automatically. He doesn't need to take out a walkie-talkie. Nothing of that needs to happen. He will just immediately trigger an alert somehow, like telepathically. So I felt like, if anything, this would be the perfect game to bring back that mechanic that he has to take out the walkie-talkie again. And I feel like that would have even been like better than the whole like give you slow motion time to take the guy out. Because that, you know, if they're giving you already a little bit of time to take the guy out in slow motion, might as well give you a little bit of time to take the guy out with a walkie-talkie. Because at least you feel better about yourself that, well, I was able to aim to the walkie-talkie really quickly. I was able to get to him quicker than, well, the game just decided to hold my hand and give me 5 extra seconds to shoot him in the head. Right? So I feel like an adjustable difficulty would have been good in this game, just like in all the other games, that there's a very easy, normal, extreme, European extreme, all that stuff. And in this game, what happens is that there's an adjustable difficulty within the game itself, in that it's kind of determines how you play and then the guards react accordingly. So in other words, let's say that you take a lot of pot shots, the guards are going to start wearing a bunch of helmets so you can't take pot shots as easily. Or let's say that you go in and just guns a-blazing, they're going to start wearing body armor, right? Or another, I don't remember exactly what you have to do, but they're going to start putting more landmines. And you can send your teams to go and take out the people in these little side missions and then they will reduce the amount of helmets or reduce the amount of shotguns or whatever. But it's just really not exactly the same as adjusting the difficulty in that it would have been cool, for example, to just how blind the guards would be, which is really what the difficulties were in the previous games. Like in European Extreme, if you would be across the map and the guard is facing your direction, he's gonna see you, no matter what. He's gonna see you, whereas in the lower difficulties, you have that little bit away that if you look straight in your direction, but you're actually, let's say, 60 meters away, he's not even gonna see anything there, right? A thing about the game is that I've always wondered too why stuff would take a while to develop. Like if you say develop this, and then some things are instantaneous, but other things are like, oh, this is gonna take 1 hour, or this is gonna take 2 hours, and you're like, why? Just give me the thing already, I earned it. Just like it was in Peace Walker. If you got enough stuff in Peace Walker, GMP, I think it was still in Peace Walker, you would automatically get it. Like, no questions asked. But here, like, you gotta wait. And then I didn't actually test this for myself, but I did read that you could buy tokens online for real money to be able to speed that process up. And I was like, oh, well, you know, easy way to make some bucks. But yeah, I just felt like, you know, there's other ways to get money out that don't involve just slowing down the game on purpose. So, oh, yeah. So I feel like, like I discussed extensively, the gameplay works amazingly well in outside areas. Like anything that you're infiltrating outside or like the big compounds, I feel it works excellent, everything about the gameplay. But once you go inside into a smaller area, like one of the little houses, or once you go into the big house where Code Talker was hiding out on the bottom, like there's where you kind of see where the gameplay doesn't really work that well with the guards, because since the guards are so hyper aware and so hyper intelligent all the time, it's really easy to get spotted. You just open the door and the guy will be like, hey, what are you doing? Boom, alert. You know, like, and you didn't do anything. It's not like you can like peek underneath the door or stuff like that with like Splinter Cell style. Like, I feel like the game was definitely designed for those large open environments, and whenever you get into a tiny environment, like one of the little shacks or that aforementioned house, it does fall apart a little bit. If you were just outside the reach of their vision, they wouldn't see you, but they would come to investigate that. And whenever you're inside that sweet spot, like you still have that in the outdoor areas, that 40 meter sweet spot, it would be actually be like literally 40 meters. Once you're indoors, chances are 40 meters is like the length of the actual thing, so they'll spot you right away. In short, the guards are simply too perceptive. So another thing I've written down here is that in Metal Gear Solid 3, it was really easy to change camouflage. You just have to go to the start menu, change your camouflage, and bam, you got a brand new one. And here, it's a little silly in just how long it takes to change the camouflage, that you have to call the supply drop, wait for the supply drop, have it come down to you, and it also costs you GMP. So it's like in a game that forces you that you have to be changing camouflage, if you really want to stay hidden as best as possible, you're gonna have to be changing camouflage. Why would it like penalize you so much? And why would it make it so long and tedious to get the different camouflage that it used to be so easy in Metal Gear Solid 3 and Metal Gear Solid 4 would just be automatic, right? But I mean, I'm not saying it has to be automatic, but it would be nice to just like split the difference. Maybe you could take two camouflages with you, you know, like in case you bring a sneaking suit and then you also bring one of the camouflages for the environment, just so you can switch between the two instead of having to call in, wait, and then it comes to you. So this brings me to the demon points system. And I feel that system is a little flawed in that not only do I feel like if you're playing the Fall of Big Boss, right? Because we didn't know that this was Venom Snake. Well, this guy's actually Big Boss, but this guy is not Big Boss, he's another guy. I'll get to that later. I know that he says that he is Big Boss, the both of them are Big Boss, I'll get to that later. But he is, for all intents and purposes, another snake, the fifth snake, right? Venom Snake. But we didn't know that back then, right? We thought it was Big Boss. So if this was a game about his downfall, about him turning into the bad guy that he is in Metal Gear 1 and 2, then why are we still being penalized for behaving like a bad guy? Why, whenever you kill somebody, it actually makes your horn grow bigger and there's nothing you can do to bring that? Well, yes, you can offset it by not killing people and by doing good things and it grows back, but I feel like, why would you punish the player so much for killing people in a game where it's supposed to be about turning into that bad guy that you turn into, right? And yes, there's a physical manifestation of becoming a demon, but you know, you just end up not looking that good with this giant triceratops horn popping out of you, or if you're washed in blood too, if you kill too many people, and then you can't even wash the blood off unless you, like, you know, build a nuke and sell it. I think I haven't done that stuff yet, but apparently you get a lot of hero points or demon points depending on building the nuke or selling the points, stuff like that. You just have to, like, why penalize the player so much just for playing around a bit? Like, it would have been nice if there was a way to deactivate that for a little bit, just so you can just go blow off some steam. Because to this day, I still I just checked my stats. I still have not stabbed a single dude in the game because I know that counts as a kill and I don't want to kill anybody. And there it says knife attacks, zero. I would like to stab some dudes. Like, I know I generally like to play not killing anybody, but you know, every once in a while, you just want to kill some people in the game. Like, it would have been nice if they would have give you that option rather than completely penalizing you. Oh, you killed somebody. Oh, demon points for you. You know, that didn't exist before. Like, if you wanted to play like that, and then you just don't save, and then it would be fine. But since the game is constantly saving, there's no way to get out of it. I loved playing in the open terrain, and I would have liked a little bit more just closed, like, interior locations, like there have been in Metal Gear Solid 1 and 2. But I understand that this game essentially, I don't know if you guys have read the older interviews of Hideo Kojima back when he was making Metal Gear Solid 3, but what he's always wanted to do is he wanted to make this open world, I don't think he used open world back then, but just this infiltration game where you're out in the jungle and you explore the jungle for hours and then you eventually get to the base and then you infiltrate the base. And that's exactly what this game is. You explore for a while and then you finally get to the base and then you find out how you're gonna infiltrate. So that he basically finally made the game that he's been wanting to make since Metal Gear Solid 3. So that's awesome. I know I've been criticizing some stuff so far, but please don't get me wrong that I did not like the game. I did like enjoy the game very much. But as a fan and as a guy who's played it all these hours, it's just, you know, you start to see the little things in the game that could have been better. Have they tweaked this or that? Like, I'm just trying to give constructive criticism here. I'm not just gonna like say I loved everything about the game, because then what's the point of watching the review if I'm just here saying how much I love absolutely everything. One little thing that's just in terms of the aesthetic standpoint is that it would have been cool to be able to play with the big boss head. And I know that you can play with a bandana, but to be able to play as the real big boss, in the sense that not one that has like the scars and the horn popping out of the head, just the standard big boss. They even showed it in the trailer, actually, in the trailer where he's like walking down this hallway and he's changing all the different ways that he's looked like from since Metal Gear Solid 3. It would have been cool to have that model that you could play as classic Big Boss rather than Venom Snake looking like Big Boss. You know, this would have been kind of like Metal Gear Solid 4, where yeah, the guy's supposed to look old because he's gonna die, but you do have the option to put the young face camo, and then it's like he's not that old. I mean, he still sounds really old, but it's it gives you a little option. And I didn't talk about the online multiplayer, because I'm not the kind of guy that plays the online multiplayer for Metal Gear Solid games. I feel like if you like Call of Duty and that sort of shooter-esque gameplay, then that's probably more for you. For me, I played it a little bit. I didn't really have that much fun with it. I didn't buy this game to play the online multiplayer, so it really was something that I wasn't too excited about for the first place. I played the online multiplayer of Subsistence a little bit, but again, it was not something that I really enjoyed, so that's why I didn't really talk about it. And the FOB missions, I think they're called, where you go and you infiltrate another guy's base, I felt like that was too stressful to not only be worried about your in-game guys, but also be worried about the in-game guys can be attacked online. So I just turned that off and I played offline the whole time, because I just wanted to focus on the story and enjoy the story for what it was, instead of worrying about other people attacking and then me attacking. And it's just like, I just refrained from doing that. I did do it once and I got the trophy, because I may go back and get all the trophies. All right, so now that was my discussion about the gameplay of Metal Gear Solid 5. I may go back into it a little bit, but now we're gonna discuss the story, which is a huge part of the game. Well, not really a huge part, but it's a big thing not to discuss in a review. So, oh yeah, spoilers, as I said before, bunch of spoilers coming up. So where to start with this story? I got a bunch of bullet points to get through with this story. So I feel that the main point of this story is, for lack of a better word, unnecessary a little bit, in the fact that we kind of already knew what caused Naked Snake to turn into that villain that we see in Metal Gear 1 and 2, in that he was forced to kill his best friend, he was betrayed by the country that he loved so much, Like, it all just got to him, right? And he ended up turning into a bad guy. Like, we kind of knew that. And going into Peace Walker, I feel like there were some things that were explored there that did deserve to be explored, like him getting over the boss. Like, he's a very important figure in his life and his trauma about it, right? And then taking off the bandana, and then that puts him kind of like one step closer to becoming the big boss that we all know that just doesn't even wear a bandana, right? So I feel what this game could have done is that it didn't have to focus so much on the story of him turning into a bad guy. No, it didn't really focus on that at all. But I feel it would have been good if we could have explored the other part of Metal Gear Solid, which was kind of just, you know, thrown like a little bomb on us on Metal Gear Solid 4, in that it turns out that Zero, that nice, joyous, happy dude that helps you in Metal Gear Solid 3, that talks about James Bond, he turns out to be the major puppet master behind everything, right? He turns out to be the major bad guy of the series. So I feel like it would have been awesome if we would have finally seen all that stuff that they were just talking about in cutscenes of Metal Gear Solid 4, that whole transition of Zero becoming a bad guy. But in the end, we don't get that. We don't get that at all. The only thing we find out about Zero is through a bunch of cassette tapes. And that's it. I think there's like 3 or 4 cassette tapes. And yes, they're very informative cassette tapes. And the guy who did his voice, it's not the original guy who did his voice, but he did a very good impersonation of him, very good approximation of him. And it was just kind of lame that this guy, this incredibly important figure in the Metal Gear mythos, is just kind of reduced to the sidelines and some cassette tapes that most people aren't even gonna get to. So we're not even gonna get to that. And then like he's on a phone call with Skullface, and then Skullface tricks him into pricking his finger. And it's all so silly and moot and anticlimactic, and it doesn't really explain a lot. And then they kind of hint that, well, they're not really hint that, but they kind of show that Zero is not really that much of a bad guy in the first place. He was also misunderstood. It's just, you know, it's good, I feel, to have like heroes and villains, like Liquid Snake. You know, Liquid Snake, a big part of why everybody loves him so much in Metal Gear Solid 1. He was a villain. Yes, he explains his motives, but he is still a villain. He's not just this misunderstood guy. Like, they try to make everybody be a misunderstood individual. No, just be a villain. It's just more entertaining, more dramatic that way. So yeah, that goes to Skullface. I feel like Skullface is the most horrible, lame villain in the entire series. That XOF was created to overlook Fox is just so forced and unnecessary. It's like, why would they create this guy? And then he's just not that intimidating. I mean, I know he looks with the Skullface, and he puts a little Zorro mask, and then his voice is just so cartoonish. It's like a Saturday morning G.I. Joe cartoon. Like, and there's no personality behind it, and there's no real driving force behind it. I mean, I know we've had slightly cartoonish voices before, like Revolver Ocelot. He's over the top, but he's an awesome character. And it totally fit him. We're not talking about the Revolver Ocelot in this game, but like the Revolver Ocelot in Metal Gear Solid 2 or 1, or even in Metal Gear Solid 4. I know he's Liquid Ocelot there, but that sort of performance, that even though it was a very like over the top voice, it didn't just sound cartoony and canned. And I felt like that's how Skullface's voice sounded. His evil plan of creating the Metal Gear and then to inspire fear and then having this kid to control it telepathically, and then he's like, you know, surprised when the kid revolts kind of against him, and then he ends up getting trampled by the Metal Gear and you don't even have a final battle with him, and then you're just forced to shoot him with a shotgun while he's there pinned down by metal. Like, I mean, personally, like I told you guys, I don't really like killing people that much in the games. I personally like to play the game non-lethally, right? So when he was there and he was just lying there, just absolutely helpless, and with the thing on him bleeding out of the mouth and then begging to get shot, like, man, that didn't feel good at all. And maybe that was the point. Maybe that was the point for you not to feel heroic at all. But still, it's just, it would have been nice to at least you put him there. Like, if they wanted to have that moment of it not feeling that great, at least you put him there. Like, for example, with the battle with the boss, I mean, this comes nowhere near close to that, but Metal Gear Solid 3, you take her down, and then you are the one that have to pull the trigger, and you feel awful about it. But that had a whole dramatic build to it, and you actually got to take her down. Like, with this guy, he gets taken down in a cutscene, and all you have to do is, I think, press R1, and then bam, he's dead? Like, you don't get any satisfaction out of it. And maybe again, like, you could argue like, oh, that was the point of not getting satisfaction out of that. But at the end of the day, it's a game, and you're supposed to like feel that connection with the game, and I felt like that connection was kind of missing with that moment. Let's talk a little bit about Quiet. I feel she's very attractive, and that's because she's actually based on a real person. She's also an actress. I was lucky enough to meet her, and I feel like her character in the game, I know her name is Quiet, so she's not going to speak unless she spoke a little bit at the end, but it would have been cool to let her, I guess it seems like contradicting myself here that I kind of liked her character, but I'm like, wish she would have spoken, but that's her whole essence of her character is that she never speaks. But I guess what I wanted to say is that it would have been cool to see another badass female character like there's been throughout the series, just like Meryl or Sniper Wolf or Eva or Naomi Hunter or Mei Ling. Like they're all special and unique and memorable and cool in their own way. And I felt like Quiet as a character, yeah, I mean, she's very noble, right? Because she sacrificed, she was essentially risking her life, right? She basically, I mean, supposedly got herself killed because of the parasites or whatever, but you know, depending on what theories you read up on, she wasn't actually gonna get killed by the parasites because she had no lungs or, like, she was risking her life to save Snake, right? And she also risked her life to go get the little thing that they dropped, that Eli dropped in the thing on Mother Base. Like, she's very noble, right? And she's very loyal, but you don't really know a lot about her because she's quiet all the time. It would have been cool to just, she could speak. And I know that's part of her character, but it would have been cool to have a character that her entire trait was not just, she's just really hot and she can't talk. Like, you know, all the other female characters are also really hot, but they also have really cool personalities too. And I know that Quiet does have a personality, it's just not that easy to see it shine through because she can't speak. I mean, I touched on this a little bit, but I was just so angry when they took her away from you. I was just, I vented about it extensively on my ending analysis. And I know I talked about it before, but yeah, if you want to see it, you can click right there. That's the, in that one, I go into in depth what I feel about the whole twist of Venom Snake and Big Boss and all of that. I talk about that, I think, for like 40 minutes. So if you want to hear that, you're welcome to go that. I mean, I'll get into it here as well, in case you don't want to go see another video right now. But for the more extensive, detailed review about the ending, you can see that. And Ocelot, I feel like I've always enjoyed the character of Revolver Ocelot. I think he's awesome, and I think he's an incredible linchpin in the series that he's always there. And he usually makes some sort of incredible statement at the end of the Metal Gear Solid entries. And I feel that in this entry, it wasn't just the fact that they changed the voice actor, like the fact that they just changed his entire personality. He was no longer that crazy, sadistic, sardonic guy that we had come to know and love. Like, he was just this completely subdued, chillaxed guy on Mother Base that would be like, no, man, like, it's cool. You know, you can bring Quiet. It's cool, man. Don't get so angry, Miller. Like, just bring him on. It's cool. Oh, hey, Snake, that's a nice plant. You should bring him back. You know, I think the plant will help us out. Like, he was just a cool dude, but he was not the Ocelot that we all knew from the previous games. He seemed like a completely different character. I mean, he dressed like him, but he didn't act like him. And I feel like that was a huge missed opportunity in that he was acting completely different. He didn't seem like the same character, and it wasn't just because of the voice. He just didn't seem like the same character at all. So Miller, I feel like the cool thing about him is that he's just so angry about everything, and he wants to get revenge for everything, and he's just so intense about absolutely any situation that arises. That's the cool part about him, is that at least you saw why he was so angry, right? And at least you understood him, and he felt like the same guy that you had come to know from Peace Walker, and even from like kind of Liquid's impersonation of him in Metal Gear Solid 1. So it was cool to see him go full circle. And I feel like at the very, very end, when Ocelot is telling Master Miller about, oh, hey, by the way, like, this guy wasn't the real Big Boss, it was this other guy, and so then there was da 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 da. And so then he's like, oh, you know what, I'm really glad you told me that, because now I'm gonna do my best to make sure that his sons overthrow him, to make sure Solid Snake is superior to Big Boss. I'm going to make sure of that. And that explains why he would have trained him at some point, or at least spoken to him or become friends with him in Metal Gear Solid 1 when Solid Snake calls him. He's like, oh, Master Miller, oh my God. Like, that explains why he would be so closely connected to him when he should have been closely connected to his father, not Solid Snake, right? So I feel that was at least a great story point for the game that brought that did not exist beforehand. Eli had a lot of potential because that really was Liquid. That's awesome. But we really didn't see much of that. I mean, he barely spoke, and then he goes away, and then it goes into that like lost chapter of the game, which I did see in the little thing. But you didn't really get to know him a lot, and being, you know, one of the few returning characters from the original, it would have been cool to see him as a kid, more of his personality, get more interaction between him and Snake. That would have been awesome, instead of him just like just insulting him a little bit and then leaving. It would have been amazing if we could have seen Sniper Wolf, because Sniper Wolf does mention that she met Big Boss right in her dying speech in Metal Gear Solid 1, that Big Boss is the one who rescued her. So it would have been so cool to play that mission where you go and you rescue the Sniper Wolf. I mean, I know Quiet is the sniper girl in this game, but it would have been cool that it was actually Sniper Wolf at some point, that we see her at some point. Snake. So he's a little difficult to talk about just because, and again, spoilers, you know, he's not really Big Boss. He is just a vessel for, he's just a vessel for the player in the sense that he is meant to be figuratively as if you were on the chopper with Big Boss, and then they perform hypnotherapy on you, and then you wake up thinking that you are Big Boss, right? So then you're kind of a vessel. And in other words, he's not gonna speak a lot, right? He's just gonna be kind of like a silent protagonist. And I felt like that kind of, it really took away so much from the character because, you know, both Solid Snake and Naked Snake, they're really chatty characters, both of them. They say a lot about many things. They always speak their mind about everything practically. And it was just so sad that, you know, such a verbose character was turned into this really boring vessel. And I know a lot of people criticize Kiefer Sutherland's performance, and I feel like part of it had to do with that he was playing a vessel. He was playing somebody interpreting Big Boss. Because if you hear his voice during the Big Boss tapes, where you actually hear the truth, right? He sounds very different. He sounds alive. Well, I think that's the best way to put it. He sounds alive in those tapes. And I feel like that could have been a Big Boss that he could have played that would have been really entertaining to see. Obviously, I do prefer David Hayter. I feel like David Hayter is and always will be Solid Snake and Big Boss. But, you know, David Hayter was not in this game for reasons that he actually went into in an interview recently that he did with Game Informer. Extremely awesome video. You guys should go see it. He talks about a lot of things about why he wasn't involved with Metal Gear Solid 5. And I mean, personally, I'm a huge fan of David Hayter. I was lucky enough to meet him. I feel like he just nailed that interpretation of the character, and like nobody will be able to come close. Like, you remember Solid Snake so much because of that voice. That's the voice that I have practiced for so many years to be able to use on my Snakes on a Date series, or my Snakes Vlog series, or Solid Snake versus Sam Fisher. Like, that is the voice that has become so like connected with the character, and I feel that they're inseparable. And I feel that no matter who ends up playing Snake in the future, in future installments or in future things, like, we will always remember and associate David Hayter's performance with that character, just like we always see Kevin Conroy as the perfect Batman or Peter Cullen as the perfect Optimus Prime. It doesn't matter who else would play it, like, we would always associate that voice with that character. So I'm not gonna go into this a lot because I already went into it in depth with that video I told you guys about, the ending analysis. But the twist that you are not playing as Big Boss, that you turn out to be playing as Venom Snake, as this guy that was made to look and act like Big Boss, I feel like I really didn't like it. I really would have liked to play as Big Boss. And I know you can pretend that you're still Big Boss, right? And I know, and I understand the poetic nature of it. I know that now that you are, like, every player is now part of Big Boss, but I feel that that kind of cheapens the story, and it cheapens who the character of Big Boss is. Like, it just, like, Big Boss is supposed to be this legendary hero that he was so amazing that they felt like they needed to clone the guy. Like, they felt like they needed to go and create other soldiers like him because he was just so perfect. I mean, here's a guy that was able to take down the entire Cobra unit by himself. That's amazing. Or a guy that was able to take down Shagohod and countless other Metal Gears in Peace Walker. Like, he was able to do that by himself. He's a legendary soldier, right? He's supposed to be something that comes once in a lifetime. And I feel that by saying that if you just hypnotize some other good soldier, and they do make a point of saying that he's his best soldier and he's the best one in his army and whatever, and they just hypnotize him, and then he's suddenly just as good as Big Boss, like, that kind of cheapens how good Big Boss is. So you're telling me that if you just have a good enough hypnotherapy with someone, then you could turn him into someone that's as good as the original. I mean, even that was the kind of the point of Solid Snake and Liquid Snake, that they cloned them, but they were still different. And then here you're telling me that, like, just through hypnotherapy, he's just as good as the original Big Boss. I feel like he didn't go through all the same experiences as Big Boss is. Like, him having to kill his mentor is a huge part of what made him him, right? And yeah, they probably implanted that memory into the guy too, but then at the end, like, I guess I'm going too much into it. If you want to hear the full version of this, just go to that video. Now, in terms of the story, and I feel like I'm definitely going to be in the minority in this, but in my personal headcanon, I don't like to think of this story as canon, because I feel like what it did contribute was just stuff that just muddled the story, the already complex story of Metal Gear, just muddled it and overly complicated it to a point where it just takes away the dramatic heft and the dramatic moments of many parts in the series rather than add to it. So, you know, one of them is, like, Big Boss is now two people instead of one person, right? Because the guy says, like, oh, we're both Big Boss, right? So now when Solid Snake goes in and takes him out in Metal Gear 1, he's not even killing the same guy anymore, right? He's not even killing, because he technically didn't kill him for Metal Gear 2, but I guess he did kill him in Metal Gear 2, in Metal Gear 1 now, because they were two different people. But it just takes away that moment of he takes out his own father, and then he comes back and he confronts him again in Metal Gear 2, but he didn't really take him out in the first place. He took out some other guy that was made through hypnotherapy to believe it was him. So it kind of, it cheapens that interaction between Solid Snake and Big Boss. Also, another thing of the story is that what would have been cool is we never get to see the turn, the final push, like the Anakin Skywalker turning into Darth Vader when he killed the younglings, right? Because that's a pivotal moment. And we got a little bit of that, right? When he has to kill the people that are infected with that virus in his own base. But that wasn't even him. That wasn't Big Boss. That was some other guy. So it even takes away from that. If you had actually been Big Boss, maybe that would have been kind of cool. But no, you're just some guy that was made to believe that he's Big Boss. So Big Boss never went through that. So he didn't go through that emotional, like, turning point for him. So in those tapes, he still sounds like this, the real Big Boss in those tapes sounds like he's just some nice guy. Like, we still don't see him turn. Like, we always got to see, we basically never got to see him turn into the villain. We never played as him as the villain. We never got to see him turn into the Darth Vader figure, right? Which is what they were been building to this whole saga. Is the fallen hero. So we never get to see him as that fallen hero, and that moment in Metal Gear Solid 4 is also cheapened. Well, not cheapened, but, like, you didn't explore that moment more in Metal Gear Solid 4 when he's at the graveyard with Solid Snake, and he says, like, maybe he would have made different choices than me. Like, there he's just acknowledging that he made some wrong choices in his life, that he became that villain. Like, it would have been cool to see those extra choices that he made that turned him down, that led him down the path of becoming this essential, like, this warmonger that they had to send someone to take out. I know he sent his own, well, that technically wasn't even him anymore because it was the other guy in the first Metal Gear, but theoretically he sent his own son thinking he would fail, but that all of that is just kind of taken away because now we never see him turn into that. And that's what this game really was for, was to see how he turned into that villain. What was the final straw? Like, see him be that evil guy, right? We never got that. We never got that transformation. Solid Snake and Liquid Snake also, they're not as special anymore because now there's a fifth snake. There's five of them, guys. Like, there's Naked Snake, there's Solid Snake, there's Liquid Snake, there's Solidus Snake, and now there's Venom Snake. There are five snakes. And at least the other guys were created with the same genetic code, right? But this guy was just some dude who they hypnotherapized, who they performed some hypnotherapy on, and then he became this legendary soldier as well. So it just kind of cheapens what was so special about Solid and Liquid, and that they were created, they were the sons of Big Boss. They were these like great mythical figures essentially. And then this guy comes along, he's like, hey, I wasn't even created out of the same genetic material and I still managed to take down a Metal Gear by myself. The Sahelanthropus, like, you know? And Skullface, he doesn't add anything to the mythology of Metal Gear. He's just a useless ancillary villain that really didn't do anything noteworthy except prick, but through a phone, managed to convince Zero to prick himself, right, and poison himself. That was like the really the major story point that he did. And aside from that, he really didn't add to it. So Skullface didn't add to it either. Here, like, all for revenge, right? All for revenge. You feel that you're taking revenge for Miller, but you don't feel that you're taking revenge for you, because you never really see Snake connect with any of this. And part of it was like, well, because you're not actually playing as Big Boss. Because Big Boss ran away. That was another thing I wanted to get to. He ran away on his motorcycle from his problems. Big Boss would never do that. Like, I feel that Big Boss would never do that because he confronts his problems. He wouldn't just let some guy just do it all for him and be like, oh, it's too dangerous for you, Big Boss. This is Big Boss we're talking about. Like, look at the incredible things he's done, and he doesn't want to do anything else because he's afraid they'll find him? That just seems so out of character for him, that he would run away like a coward, that he would run away like that. Why would he do that? I don't feel that it was dangerous enough to merit that he just leaves it entirely in the hands of this other guy. I feel too that Peace Walker connects perfectly to that first Metal Gear because it sets everything up beautifully. You are creating the base that you eventually take down as Solid Snake. You are recruiting that army, right? And that he refers to it at the end of the game, this is Outer Heaven, right? And he says, you now call me Big Boss. Like, he tells that to Miller. No longer, don't call me Snake anymore. Like, he had finally turned. That was pretty much the turning point, right? When he said, no, because the boss put down her gun. And if she put down her gun, she put down everything that came before that, including me. So I'm not gonna be like her. I'm not gonna put down my gun, right? And he's gonna become Big Boss. And that was awesome, and that was badass. And the speech that he gave, the two speeches, the speech that he gives at the end, the true ending of the game, it's nothing short of amazing. Like, it is one of the coolest speeches I've ever heard in a video game, and it's awesome. It's a great, powerful moment, and it sets up Metal Gear perfectly. And then the fact that Ground Zeroes and Phantom Pain come along, and then it turns out that that base that you built, that wasn't the real Outer Heaven. You're gonna build another one. Like, what? What? Then why'd I go through all that trouble to do it? Like, it's just, it would've been cool that would've been the bridge. So my personal theory is that Hideo Kojima just really liked what he did with Peace Walker. He really enjoyed the mechanics of it, how like it was just tactical espionage operations as opposed to action. In other words, there was a mother base element, there was a cyclical nature of it. You would choose what mission you wanted to do. Like, that's what he liked about it. And I think that deep down, he just wanted to make a game just like Peace Walker, but he didn't want to repeat himself and just make Peace Walker Super HD version, right? Because he technically did make Peace Walker HD. Well, they did make Peace Walker HD, and he didn't want to just kind of make the super, like a Twin Snakes, I guess? Like a revisited version of the original game, but just entirely overhauled with new mechanics and new graphics and all this stuff, right? He didn't just want to do that, and I think that's why he created a new story that so people would be interested in playing this untold part of the saga. But I personally would have been fine playing again Peace Walker again. And I feel like a lot of people didn't even know about the Peace Walker PSP game anyway. So he could have just called it something else and then still just taken out Peace Walker again, and we all would have bought it. All the Metal Gear fans would have still bought it, and the people that had never played another Metal Gear entry before would have probably bought it too. My brother and I both feel that the story, that the huge twist was just so foretold and so easy to see coming. I mean, my brother and I actually did a podcast, I think like 10 months before the game even came out, where the title of it it was something along the lines of, is Venom Snake not Big Boss? Question mark, right? back then, and then we were talked about that theory, and it wasn't just us. The entire Metal Gear community was talking about this theory that Venom Snake is not Big Boss. There was this other theory going around that he was actually Cyborg Ninja. Well, not Cyborg Ninja, but Frank Yeager, right? And that, I mean, we talked about that in the video too, but we didn't think that he was gonna turn out to be Gray Fox. We thought that he was just gonna be this completely different character, right? And that's what we talked about in that video. We proposed a bunch of other crazy theories of why you're actually playing. We thought there was like a VR mission at some point, and we proposed a lot of interesting stuff. But yeah, but the fact that not only us, but the entire Metal Gear community was able to come up with this theory that Venom Snake is not Big Boss, and then lo and behold, Venom Snake is not Big Boss. Like, what kind of a twist was that? Like, it's not like the twist in Metal Gear Solid 2 that everybody wasn't really excited or happy about, in that you don't play as Solid Snake, you play as Raiden, but at least nobody saw that one coming. Here, everybody saw that one coming. So it was just forced, you know, it was just kind of like shoehorned in there. You didn't really, there was nothing in the game that was leading up to it. Yes, there was these tiny moments where like the AI pod was like, Jack, is that you? No, that's not Jack. Or even Otacon, well, Otacon's dad, when he looked at him, he was like, oh, you look a little different. And like people they were dropping hints. Or when they said like, yeah, they're not your genetic match. He's not your son. Well, no, he's not your son because you're some other guy. That's why the genetic match didn't come back. But like, I feel like those hints, they weren't encompassing. It wasn't a big narrative that was just leading toward it. It just kind of happened. It's just like, oh, by the way, you're not Big Boss. It's like, oh. And so another thing with the game too, is that although splitting up the game into various missions helps so much with the gameplay because you're able to go into any little part that you want and you can just replay that story or replay that mission, in terms of the story, there is plenty of them that you don't really know why you're doing what you're doing. Like, why are you getting these documents? Why are you rescuing this guy? Yeah, they tell you, but it just felt so much like Splinter Cell, where you're just doing something. And I personally, I like Splinter Cell too, but the thing about Splinter Cell is you always feel lost, completely lost in terms of the story, what's going on or who's saying what. And there was a little bit of that in this one too, because there's so many extraneous missions that don't really contribute to the main narrative of the game that you end up feeling like, why am I getting this document? Why was this so important? So because of all these reasons and more is why we feel, my brother and I feel, that this entry in our head canon, we just don't see it as canon because it just complicates and convolutes and cheapens other dramatic points within the saga. It doesn't add anything that really enriches the experience. It just adds things that confuse the experience more and take away from that dramatic impact that you have in these different moments in the game. And we just consider it more of like a Metal Gear Solid, like a Metal Gear Ghost Babel or Metal Gear Acid, like a sort of like what if scenario. And as it doesn't really enrich the experience that much in terms of the story. And the gameplay, obviously it does. But in terms of the story, we just don't feel it that way. Because like we want to remember Big Boss as a legendary hero that fell from grace only to redeem himself and die with his son. You know, just like it was in Star Wars. That is awesome. That is epic. That's memorable. That's amazing drama that stays with you, right? I just don't want to remember Big Boss as a coward that just ran away from his problems. Those are my two cents on the story itself. And the cutscenes, I felt like there were quite a few of them were really cool. And the one take thing worked well for the most part. I just wish there were more memorable cutscenes because when I was replaying it again, I felt like there aren't any cutscenes that you just remember that stay with you. They just sort of happen. So it would have been nice to have a couple of more cutscenes that really just stay with you, like the entire ending of Metal Gear Solid 3 for me. Like, I can still remember every single emotional beat of that, no matter how many times I played or how long it's been since I last played it. You still remember that. You remember certain shots about it. But with this one, I never felt that quite connected to the cutscenes. And they also primarily took place on other base. It would have been nice to see other locations. We did occasionally see cutscenes take place in other locations, but mostly it was just Mother Base. So a couple closing remarks on Metal Gear Solid 5. I think the gameplay is brilliant, and I think it's the best that I've ever seen in the entire series. Just the fact that it's basically an infiltration simulator. It's awesome to play, and I keep finding myself playing it again and again because it's just really fun. It's undeniably fun. It is so cool. And the story, I just felt like I just went through so extensively. I just felt so disappointed and let down with the story that there just could have been so much stuff that we could have explored that was just hinted at in the other games. And yet we just found this story that I felt didn't really add much to the lore. As a matter of fact, I feel like it complicated the lore. And it, yeah, I just wish the story would have turned out into something more. I wish the story would have turned out into something more memorable, into something we would like to revisit and see again. I do feel like the story is probably the weakest of the entire saga of Metal Gear. Because, like, I mean, you compare this story to the stories of Metal Gear Solid 1 or 2 or 3 or 4, like, it's just nowhere near as memorable. So all in all, I sincerely loved the gameplay, and I felt like the story was incredibly weak, but I feel like just the perfect gameplay compensates for weaknesses in the story that I went through. So that's my review. Please let me know what you guys think of the game in the comments below, and you can also follow me on my Twitter and Instagram at Godzillarex. Make sure to subscribe to the channel. I already got a bunch of Metal Gear videos already, like Solid Snake versus Sam Fisher, Snakes on a Date with Zelda, those are both live action. And I also have analysis videos where I talk about all these other games in the Metal Gear Solid saga. So thank you so much for watching. See you guys next time.